In this video, we're going to be creating a cash flow statement using only the balance sheet and the income statement of the company. Hey, welcome to the channel. I'm Dobri. This is Minty Analyst. The cash flow statement is one of the three main financial statements, and it shows the sources and uses of cash for the company. Most companies nowadays report their financial statements on an accrual basis. This means showing revenue whenever we make a sale instead of as a cash inflow whenever the cash is actually received for the respective sale. So in this video, we'll be using the income statement and balance sheet of a company to create its cash flow statement in Excel. If you want to follow along, there's a link in the description below where you can download the Excel file that we'll be using. Now let's open Excel and dive straight in. So here I have my income statement and my balance sheet underneath it, and those are all already projected or already have it historical. And what I want to do is going to build a cash flow statement, and I already have the structure here, and you can download the file from the description down below with some checks in here. And let's see how we can approach this in order to generate a cash flow statement fast using the indirect method. So the way the indirect method works is you have your three types of cash flows, those coming from operating activities, investing, and financing activities. And this is the same between the direct and indirect method. The only difference is that in the operating cash flows section for the indirect method, we're starting from what we have in our income statement, which is accrual basis. And then we're doing some adjustments, add backs or deductions to bring it down to our cash from operations under the cash basis, meaning that we're not considering when, let's say, a sale was made. We're considering when the revenue came in. We're going to start with net earnings. I'm just going to link that to my net earnings up above. And you see that I'm starting from the second tier. And the reason for that is that in order to calculate the changes in working capital, we need the previous year. Based off of this information alone, we cannot calculate the 2020 cash flow statement because we don't have the 2019 numbers. Okay, then we need to add back the depreciation. And you see here, depreciation is shown with a positive sign. So I'm just gonna link it up to here, depreciation and amortization. Interest, same thing, just go up here and link it to this one. And depending on the way you're looking at it, your interest may be considered more of an operating account, then I won't be adding it back. I'll just leave it within net earnings. But what I prefer to do is I'll add it back here and then deduct it down here with my repayment of debt, including interest. So then the changes in working capital. You see here in the total that I'm deducting the changes in working capital. It says less changes in working capital. You can do it directly in here. Just add a minus at the beginning, but I prefer to keep it like that because it's easier to track. So my changes in working capital should look at all the assets and liabilities that I consider working capital. Here, I'm just going to open a bracket. I'm going to say my accounts receivable in this year minus my accounts receivable in the year before. This is the change, plus my inventory in this year minus my inventory in the year before. And I also want to grab the payables changes, but I want to start those with a negative sign because the balance sheet, you know how it works. So liabilities are on the credit side of accounts. And again, I'm going to open bracket and I'm going to say this year minus last year. I'm also going to add my other liabilities here as well. I'm going to say plus other liabilities minus other liabilities in the prior period. We don't have anything here, but it's going to come up in future years. So I want to have it in the formula already. I'm going to close the brackets. That's our formula. We're taking the changes in the assets with a positive sign and then the changes in the liabilities with a negative sign. This is my change in working capital, but we need to deduct that. And that's what we're doing here. And the reason for that is that, let's say here, we're grabbing the increase or decrease in accounts receivable, increase in this example. But in reality, if our accounts receivable are increasing, this means that we had sales that we didn't get the cash for. So it's decreasing our cash overall. That's why we're adding it with a negative sign down here. Next thing in our investing cash flow, I'm going to start with our investments in property and equipment. And because this is an outflow, I'm going to start with a negative sign. I'm going to open a bracket. I'm just going to grab the change between my two periods for my property, plant and equipment. But I'm also going to add back my depreciation because we have an increase of about 20,000 here. But this is actually net of the decrease that came from depreciation. So in reality, this increased with more than 20,000. It increased with the 20,000 plus the 45,000 of depreciation. I'm going to add it back here,
close the brackets, and those are my investments in property and equipment. For the acquisition of goodwill, this happens when we acquire other companies, and I'm going to say that this is going to be equal, again, negative sign, and I'm just going to grab the change in goodwill, which is zero. And because we generally don't amortize goodwill, that's why I put all the depreciation and amortization up here and nothing in here. Even if there's some intangibles that you'll separate on a separate line here, you can still get away with using depreciation and amortization as a total if you don't have it broken down, because the total calculation would still be correct. It would be a small misrepresentation up in here. This is my acquisition of goodwill. The next one is the dividend income or payment. In my case, we don't have any income from dividends in the income statement. So I'm just going to look for payments, and this is going to be negative again because it's an outflow. Open bracket. Just going to look for the change between retained earnings from this year and retained earnings from last year. Those increased, but this increase is only due to the result for this year. Gonna deduct this one as well. And that way I'm gonna see if there's an additional change apart from our net earnings. And this is gonna be my movement in dividends being paid out. Okay, close this one as well. Moving down to our financing cash flow. I have the issuance and repayment of debt in the same line. So what I'm gonna say here is I'm gonna grab my debt without a negative sign before that, because it's in the liabilities. I'm going to say that need the change between those two periods. And in this case, if it was going up, it would be utilization of new debt. Or if it's going down, as it's here, it's a repayment of debt. But I also want to add my interest here with a negative sign because it's a cash outflow. And my last one is the changes in equity. So if we, for example, issued new shares, or if we bought our own shares back, and this is just going to be the difference in my equity capital from this year minus the balance from last year. Okay, now we have our financing cash flow. We have our net increase or decrease in cash, which is the sum of those three. This is just the sum, and this is just the sum. The only difference is here where we're summing all those, but remember we're deducting the changes in working capital. That's why we have the less up here. And we need to link our opening cash balance. I'm just going to link it to the previous closing cash balance. And now down here, I'm going to link my closing cash balance from the balance sheet for 2020. Now this comes here and you see that we have our closing cash balance, and it reconciles with our balance sheet cash and cash equivalents balance for 2021. If we link everything correctly, we can just copy all those to the side and all those checks should zero out. This one is the cash, which compares the closing cash balance from the balance sheet up here to what we get in the cash flow statement. The next one is the net income, and here it's always going to be the same because we're linking from one to the other, but I still like to have this check in my file structure because sometimes you might link those differently. The next one is the depreciation and amortization. The same thing. It's pretty obvious here that it's the same because we're linking between the two. However, if we're working on a model and you have different schedules and you're accumulating those from different schedules, then it's a good idea to have this check down here. And the same thing for interest as well. If you have like a debt repayment schedule, you might be linking from there instead of directly from the income statement. Now let's grab all those down to here, copy them over to the side with Control R, and that's our cash flow statement. Everything reconciles and everything matches, and it only took us a few minutes to prepare.
That's all I had for you today, but if you want to learn how to forecast your income statements, check this video out. It's going to show you how to use assumptions to create dynamic forecasts for your income statement. Thank you guys for watching. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Also, don't forget to subscribe if you're not already, and maybe even punch the bell icon to receive notifications every time I upload a new video. Till then, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.